Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Spirit of life, in whom we live and move and have our being, we worship you. We thank you for your presence among us and in your whole creation. Fill us with your power, that by truthful words, just actions, and shared life, we may witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
When Bill Keel came to campus, you can be seated. It was a great addition. This was, what, about a year ago? No? Bill came from the Minnesota Twins, where he was doing some PR work and knows all of the right people. So maybe someday you can get Kirby here to speak in chapel. And Bill entered into the spirit of this life of Augsburg in such a nice way. He's faithful at chapel and understands what we're about here. He's now ahead of admissions for weekend college. But one thing that you don't know about him was he's from an all-American family, literally. They were the Minnesota All-American family in 1971. And I hope we hear a little bit about that. Anyway, welcome, Bill.
Thank you, Dave. When Dave Wold first approached me about speaking in chapel, I wondered, what would I talk about? But over the weeks, as time passed, this became a little bit more apparent to me. And I realized that what I kept seeing was, how can I positively affect the world in which I live? And I could start by quoting the Golden Rule and other such rhetoric, but I think that that question could be better answered by sharing some stories. And I've got three amazing stories that I'd like to share today that I think that would better articulate an answer to the question. And then that way you can internalize it within yourselves. Let me begin by sharing a story on courage, as was told to me by a good friend. He said many years ago, when he worked as a volunteer at Stanford Hospital, he got to know a little girl named Liza, who was suffering from a rare and serious disease. Her own chance of recovery appeared to be by a blood transfusion from her 5-year-old brother, who had also miraculously survived the same disease and had developed the antibodies needed to combat the illness. The doctor explained the situation to her little brother and asked the boy if he'd be willing to give his blood to his sister. He saw him hesitate only for a moment before taking a deep breath and saying, "Yes, I'll do it to help save my sister." As the transfusion progressed, he lay in bed next to his sister and smiled, seeing the color returning to her cheeks. Then his face grew pale and his smile faded. He looked up at the doctor and asked with a trembling voice, "Will I start to die right away?" Being young, the boy had misunderstood the doctor. He thought he was going to have to give his life through his blood unconditionally so that she could live. I think that's really unique. I think that young children say it best, and they are so honest and completely unconditional in the way that they react. Another story also struck me, and this actually could have occurred a few months ago when Dave Wold was down in Cancun. A man was walking down a deserted Mexican beach at sunset. As he walked along, he began to see another man in the distance. As he grew nearer, he noticed the local native kept leaning down, picking something up, and throwing it into the water. Time and again, he kept hurling things into the ocean. As he approached even closer, he noticed the man was picking up starfish. These starfish had been washed up onto the beach, and one at a time, he was throwing them back into the water. It was puzzling to watch, but as he approached the man, he said, "Good evening, friend. I was wondering what you're doing." "Well, I'm throwing the starfish back into the ocean. You see, the low tide right now has brought these starfish up onto the beach. And if I don't throw them back into the sea, they will die from lack of oxygen." "I understand," responded the other. "But there must be thousands of starfish on the beach. You can't possibly get to all of them. There are simply too many. And don't you realize that this is probably happening all over the other beaches up and down the coast?" The man said, "You know, I need to do this." The other man said, "Can't you see that you can't possibly make a difference?" The local native smiled, bent down, picked up yet another starfish, and as he threw it back into the sea, he replied, "Made a difference to that one." And finally, one last story on taking risks. Two seeds lay side by side in the fertile soil. The first seed said, "I want to grow. I want to send my roots deep into the soil beneath me and thrust my sprouts through the earth's crust above me. I want to unfurl my tender buds like banners to announce the arrival of spring. I want to feel the warmth of the sun on my face and the blessings of the morning dew on my petals." And so she grew. The second seed said, "I am afraid. If I send my roots into the ground below, I don't know what I will encounter in the dark. If I push my way through the hard soil above me, I may damage my delicate sprouts. What if I let my buds open and a snail eats them? And what if I open my blossoms and a small child pulls me from the ground? No, it's much better for me to wait until it is safe." And so she waited. And a yard hen scratched around in the early spring ground for food, found the waiting seed, and promptly devoured it. Those of us who refuse to risk and grow get swallowed up by life. Dare to care about the people around you. It doesn't have to be earth-shattering. It just needs to be from the heart. Grow, love, and live. Thank you.
Let us pray. God, you came to the world in Jesus Christ, teaching disciples to love and forgive, showing compassion to individuals and crowds, calling for a response of faith. Teach us what it means to be risk takers, to be your disciples, to make a difference. Call us to the responses of faith that we need to make. Keep us aware of where you are at work, of what you are doing, of what you want us to be. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks, Bill, and thanks for all you do for Augsburg. I want to make a couple of reminders of announcements here. One is the Bread for the Journey concert. We've been having them for the last few years, and Ray, of course, is part of that group, along with Tom Witt from Center for Global Ed, and Mary Preuss, Brett Hesla, Ray's wife, Linda Breitag, and a couple of others. It's really good stuff, as you know, those of you who have been here in past years. And we filled the chapel every time they come. So we're going to two nights this year, and it's being recorded. So if you've ever wanted to be on a CD, come. It's a donation. You could come. If you don't have any money, you can still come. Friday night, 7 o'clock. Saturday night, 7 o'clock. We'd love to fill it twice this year, and I think we can do it. So think of that. Tomorrow, Lila is in chapel, and her offerings in the past have been really special, so we look forward to the music and word presented in a rather creative way. I just thought, as Bill talked too, I was on at a conference in San Antonio last weekend, and to get back, I had to go through Cincinnati, and I sat next to some people who, and starting a conversation, I said, home of Big O, Oscar Robertson, great basketball player. And immediately everyone around me started talking about him, because he had just given his daughter his kidney. And there was a match with a sister, but Big O said, and any of you that know basketball know about Big O, one of the great players to have ever played the game, he said, I'm older. I need to do this. I want to do this. And in the world of sports, it was just a refreshing thing for all the people of Cincinnati to see a father give that kind of love to his daughter. And I think that what Bill said about giving in your first story prompted that. And that's what we're all about here, looking for ways to give. And we did it last week with helping the flood, and there still may be some more work to do. So thank you all for taking that spirit. Now receive the benediction. May the Lord go before you to guide you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, and around you to give you strength. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks for joining. Really great story.
The other ones that just grabbed me in the last few weeks.
Thank you.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Our gracious God, like a loving parent, you nurture and encourage and challenge us to grow in grace. Grant that by sensing your Spirit's presence in our midst, we may be enabled to mature in our commitment to you. Forgive our failures and show us once again our possibilities. Prepare us to be servants of your will and agents of your love in all the world. Amen.
Then sings my soul, my Savior. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in Christ. I cannot believe I'm a senior sitting here telling you about what it's meant to me. It's meant so much. If I could describe it in one word, I'd say awesome. There's no other word. My professor, friends, Sadie Curtis, awesome. Thank you. Let me tell you, I couldn't have achieved all the goals I've set for myself and my expectations without you. Throughout those times of trials, I've prayed that God might grant me the strength and the courage to endure those times. And I'm sure that God has used many of you to help me. I fly, but not I. I once heard that in a sermon at church. See, it's similar to if you're going to fly to Florida, you say, I'm flying to Florida. But in fact, you're not flying to Florida. The plane is flying for you. And your job is to just obey the captain and sit back, relax, and enjoy the flight. Similar to the Christian life, we are just to obey God's commandments and just enjoy the life that he provides. Do not fear in anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, shall guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That is one verse that I've held on to throughout all of my 4 years here. It's been scary going through trials, but then again, I find that God always provides a way or people to help me through those trials. Once again, I just thank you. I'm sure that many, with the help of my, I also believe that it's those people who have inspired me throughout the years. I look at President Anderson and Pastor Wald and I just say, wow, what godly men. They're amazing. They have humble spirits and they show compassion towards everyone. My junior year at school, I took a class from Paul Grauer, and during that class he handed out a definition from the Minnesota coaching staff or Minnesota football staff, and it was on integrity, and it says, it goes like this: integrity is standing up for what is right and condemning what is wrong without being self-righteous in the process. Integrity is being honest and fair, first with yourself, then with your loved ones, and finally with your fellow man. A man of integrity thanks God for the gift of life and attempts to love and forgive others as he has been loved and forgiven. Integrity does not guarantee wealth, success, status, or power, but it does ensure the respect and trust of others and the inner strength of knowing that you have lived your life as it was meant to be. I say amen. Anna. Integrity in FCA. Wow, FCA has meant so much to me this year. I love getting together with a group of about 20 of us and just sharing just our testimonies and different lessons in the Bible and tell each other what it means to each of us. Oh, some sweet fellowship. That's what I say. In October, I shared with some of you at FCA about how the time I asked Christ into my life. And for some of you who weren't there, I'll just share a little bit with you. As a young child, I learned to pray, and I, you know, just before I went to bed, and I learned that there was a God, but I didn't really have the time or make the time to learn more about him. Well, when I was 17 years old, I asked God to take my life and make it his, whatever he had to do. And I just said, Lord, just please take my life and make it yours. And I didn't know what I was in for, but so then, well, it was it's turned out to be just a wonderful time. Many trials, it's produced a pretty strong, times of trial. And as it says in James 1:1-2 and 3, consider it all joy, my brethren, for your, I forgot that one. Anyway, that's so me. Well, in October, I shared with some of you that testimony, and now I'm going to show it to you. But before I share the tape, I want to take some time for sure and thank my family members and my mom and dad both are on trips in different parts of the country, and they weren't able to be here. And my brothers are in school, my sister's in Arizona, but I'd like to thank them, and I'd like to thank my grandma, too, because hopefully someday she'll watch this on tape and know how much I thank her, just for being an inspiration to me and helping me throughout my life. And I want to thank my grandfather, Greg Andrews, who's up in heaven, God willing, and just for providing a way for me to come to college. And I just, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay.
Normal thought this day would be possible, but not only did he graduate from high school, Lori has been accepted at Augsburg College in Minneapolis.
I don't know what to say after that. Many of you do know Lori's story, and if you don't know her story, we have it chronicled on a series of tapes that all of the local TV stations kind of followed her after her accident. She really wasn't given much hope, as I understand it, and bounced back in an incredible way. And we sometimes show that tape to prospective students or confirmation groups that come in here, and there's never a dry eye, of course, after seeing that. But what you have overcome and your tremendous faith is an inspiration to all of us, Lori, and we're going to miss that. But you'll be back often, hopefully. Let's pray.
Yours is the ultimate claim on our lives, O God. Help us to listen for it in all the other claims that are made on us. We cannot do everything. Help us get our priorities right, to know what you want us to do right now and what we have to leave. Lori has shown us the important things this day and these years while at Augsburg, and we thank you for the gift of Lori and the gifts that she has, thanks to your hand in her life. May the stress and strain of our lives not break us, but make us stronger for Jesus' sake. Amen. Now we're going to sing Lori's absolute favorite hymn, which is "And Can It Be?" And she said "Loud," okay?
And shouldst die for me.
A reminder that tomorrow's chapel will be a prelude to the two concerts on Friday and Saturday night. It's Bread for the Journey, featuring Ray and about half dozen others. It's going to be really outstanding chapel and outstanding concerts. Come tomorrow, chapel. Come for the concerts either Saturday or Friday or Saturday, 7 o'clock. Now receive the benediction, as requested by Lori also. May the Lord go before you to guide you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, and around you to give you strength. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
I love to sing. You know, I think I've been singing since the day I was born. My mother told me once that when I was a toddler, I used to sing myself to sleep. And I remember walking home from kindergarten, making up songs about birds and flowers and rocks in the road and whatever, and singing them at the top of my lungs. It was such an exhilarating experience. Music has always meant a lot to me. Certain songs can bring back vivid memories and strong emotions. His Eye Is on the Sparrow has the most meaning for me because the first time my mother heard me sing in church, I sang this song. I chose it because the words had so much meaning to me. My mother cried, and she said that it had always been a favorite of hers. It was then that I realized the power of music to touch someone deeply. This fall, my grandfather passed away. The day after he died, my family called me at school and said that his wish was that I perform some type of music at his funeral. He always was one of my biggest fans. I chose this song because the words offered such solace and hope. It assured me that when song gives place to sighing, and when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to him from care he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, so I know he watches me. The message is so clear. Even in the darkest hours of our lives, we can call upon God, and he will be watching over us. Recently, in one of my classes, my professor asked each person, "Why do you sing?" At the time, I couldn't really articulate any specific reason why I did. I only knew that it had a very profound and personal effect on me. Since then, I've been deeply pondering this question so that I could understand why I sing. Something that I read in preparation for this chapel talk really resonated with me. It made me see more clearly what my motivations really were. The quote is from Meister Eckhart, a 14th century mystic and theologian. In a sermon to his congregation, he said, "It often happens that what seems trivial to us is more important to God than we think. We ought simply to follow where God leads, that is, to do what we are most inclined to do, to go where we are repeatedly admonished to go, to where we feel most drawn. If we do that, God gives us his greatest in our least and never fails." God gives us his greatest in our least and never fails. Think about that. In our least, our ugliest, darkest, or most humble form, God gives us his greatest love, support, and guidance. We only need to recognize and accept that and know that it's there for us. Even though I've been singing for as long as I can remember, I never gave it any importance or significance in my spiritual life. I just knew I liked to sing. What more could there be to it? In hindsight, though, I can see that it has meant much more than that to me. In my life, I have been to the heights, and I have been to the depths. In my depths, I was at my least. For a long time, I was trapped in the throes of deep depression. I could not find joy in life or in living. I almost gave up hope and faith. But instead, I cried to God from the depths, and he heard my cries. God sent his message of love and compassion through music. I went to church and heard people singing. It was there I found an opportunity to sing with other people who liked to sing as much as I did. I joined the choir and went to church every Sunday to experience the joy of singing. The music alone could not have kept me there, though. I could sing with other people or on my own. There was something else that attracted and enthralled me. It was the words. Words like, "Jesus loves me, and just as I am." I was overwhelmed by this amazing grace that could save a wretch like me. These were the words I needed to hear, and God made sure that I heard them. He used music to communicate his message of love because he knew that that was the language I would best understand. And God knew exactly when I needed to hear those words. His timing was impeccable. When everyone else pushed me away, God pulled me into his arms. When people called me an outcast, Jesus called me one of his own. When I had no friends, Jesus was my friend. And what a friend we have in Jesus. So now what? Now that I've heard the message and understand, why should I keep on singing? What more does God require of me? Elizabeth O'Connor, in her book, Eighth Day of Creation, speaks to this question of responding to God's love. She writes, "We ask to know the will of God without guessing that his will is written into our very beings. We perceive that will when we discern our gifts. Our obedience and surrender to God are in a large part our obedience and surrender to our gifts. This is the message wrapped up in the parable of talents. Our gifts are on loan. We are responsible for spending them in the world, and we will be held accountable. Like the rich man in the parable, God has divvied out to each person their portion of talents. To some he has given many, and to others only a few, according to how capable they are of using them. But each person is called to follow the example of our Lord in self-giving love by offering our gifts of time, talents, and treasures to others. If we hide our talents like the third servant, we deny ourselves the joy and fulfillment of being who we were created to be. Each of us has been entrusted with these gifts of grace. It is up to us to step forward with our talents and ask to be used as we are for accomplishing God's will. You may be saying to yourself, but I'm not a great musician or an artist or a public speaker. What talents do I have that God could use? The answer is that you have many more talents than you realize. We too often view talent as only artistic expression. Talents come in many shapes, sizes, and areas. There is a need for every person's talent, whether they be cooking, teaching, doing taxes, or just listening. In her book, Gifts of Grace, Mary Schramm relates a story of a congregation that is seeking to discover the gifts and talents of its members so that they could employ them in their ministry. One man, Bob, said that what he enjoyed doing more than anything was building model airplanes. The others laughed and told him, "We're talking about gifts for ministry." The man was adamant, though. His gift, he said, was building model airplanes, and he really enjoyed doing it. The next week, the pastor stopped by the local playground and asked the director if there was anything the congregation could do for them. The director responded, "Come to think of it, I do have 8 boys who need to get ready for a model airplane contest. Do you have anyone who could help them?" The pastor replied in the affirmative, and the connection was made between Bob and the boys. Bob gathered the boys in his basement twice a week and taught them about making model airplanes, but he also taught them much more. Through his caring and the joy and love he expressed, Bob witnessed to these boys his faith. Martin Buber once said that every person born into this world represents something new, something that has never existed before, something original and unique. It is my duty to know that there has never been anyone like me in the world, for if there had been, there would be no need for me in the world. Every single person is a new thing in the world and is called upon to fulfill a particularity in this world. We each have a place in this world, but we need to work together to help each other discover our own talents and find a way to employ them for the service of others. It is a great risk to discover and to share our talents, but if we risk nothing, we gain nothing. If we withhold our gifts, we can never feel completely fulfilled. There will always be a missing element. There is a joy in risk. When we come humbly to God and present our simple gifts, we are open to experiencing peace and happiness. We find ourselves overcome by love and surprised by joy. So why do I sing? My life flows on in endless song. Above earth's lamentation, I hear a clear, though far off, hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm while to that rock I'm clinging. It sounds an echo in my ear. How can I keep from singing? Would you please pray with me the prayer printed in your bulletin? We offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We will sing the first stanza of How Can I Keep From Singing, number 260.
Thank you. since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing?
Thanks, Sherrie. You have been a great part of campus ministry, very faithful to your service, especially in your early years here, and thanks for being so honest also. It was a wonderful disclosure, courageous thing. And thanks for sharing your gift, also of song. Receive the benediction. As for you, child of God, do not quench the spirit. Test everything, abstain from every form of evil, hold fast to what is good. And may the God of peace sanctify you entirely, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Dear God, the mystery of your presence is a source of joy. Our sure and certain hope lies in you, and in your power to grant us life, and in the bread of life which you give us, which sustains us beyond sorrow, even beyond death, as we travel to newness in the risen Christ, who lives and rules with you within our world today. Amen. Please rise for the reading of the scriptures. The first reading today is taken from the first chapter of Mark. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you, I am well pleased." The second reading comes from the first chapter of John. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, But the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God. Here ends the reading.
May the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This past fall, I was doing some research on Augsburg College as I wrote a chapter in a book that will feature the college and its history of experiential education and community service. In the process of reviewing Carl Chrislock's book, From Fjord to Freeway, I discovered and reaffirmed again why, with all the struggles of faith, I've been as comfortable as I have been here at Augsburg. Because I revisited the history of Bernard Christensen, a history that probably many of you may not even know about, but I want to share his struggles and I think a tradition that is at the heart of the Free Church and certainly the reason I have been at home here. Bernard Christensen graduated from the college in 1922, went to seminary, and then, like was often the case in those days, was tapped by his colleagues to go off and get a graduate degree and come back. He went to Princeton, finished a master's degree and a BD degree in a year, and then studied at Columbia and Hartford, then spent a year at the University of Berlin and stopped on the way back in Scandinavia and had long conversations with a Kierkegaard scholar. And let me read now from Carl Chrislock's book. Christensen's years as a graduate student were marked by considerable inner turmoil as he groped with the problem of relating the Christian faith as interpreted by his own religious tradition to the realities of 20th century life. Princeton, where he specialized in apologetics and systematic theology, he enjoyed very much, but he mildly deplored its strong tendency to stress absolute correctness of the Calvinistic position. At the University of Berlin, where he investigated the philosophical background of semantics, Christensen discovered an environment conducive to study, quote, such as I have longed for all my life. In contrast to Princeton's system oppression, a freer climate prevailed, although the professors at Berlin were less liberal than Christensen had really expected, he said. After his return from Europe, Christensen's relationship with Augsburg passed through a brief but decisive crisis. The Board of Trustees had voted him a stipend to facilitate completion of his work at Hartford, with the understanding that he would shortly join the Augsburg faculty. Before these arrangements were completed, sharp disagreement developed between Christensen and Sven Oftedal. in Sven Oftedal's son, Osmond, who was a member of Augsburg's Board of Trustees and the associate pastor of the church where Christensen was serving. The younger Oftedal regarded rejection of verbal inspiration as the first step toward modernism and the very subversion of Christianity. Well, clearly they got into an intense debate, with the result being that Oftedal recommended to the trustees that Christensen not be offered a position at Augsburg. Sverdrup, the president, not only rejected that position, but insisted, along with the theology faculty, that Christensen be given an opportunity to write his own faith statement and submit it to the faculty, which he did. He wrote a statement in one paragraph, and I share this. I believe that the Bible contains the record of the historical revelation of God to the people of Israel, culminating in the perfect revelation in his Son. I believe that this record is so clear that for the purposes of the practical Christian life, it constitutes a sufficient guide in all matters of faith and conduct. But in the scientific study of theology, I do not believe that we can avoid a consideration of the historical-critical research that has been carried out in the last 100 years. These critical studies I do not look upon as hindrances, but rather as helps to the true understanding of the Scripture. In general, though by no means in detail, I believe that the methods and the results of historical criticism must be accepted if we are to have a theological message for those of our people who think earnestly and deeply. The theological faculty at Augsburg read that statement, advised Christensen to accept the stipend, and invited him to Augsburg. The texts we read today, I think, illustrate the struggles that Bernard Christensen must have felt all through his life, and I certainly do. You pick up the text and you read Mark, that beautiful, simple text of Jesus' baptism. In those days, Jesus from Nazareth was baptized by John in the Jordan, and he came up out of the water, and he saw the heavens open and the Spirit descending on him. And he heard the voice, "You are my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." And then an interesting phrase, "And the Spirit drove him into the wilderness where he spent 40 days. Well, then one goes to the Gospel of John. And as this writer struggled, perhaps some 30, 40 years later, to make sense of the most powerful mystery and force that had ever been encountered in human experience, wrote that story in powerful terms that left one only with a sense that this was God who walked down that path. And John the Baptist encountered God, not a man from Nazareth. But as that gospel writer tries to make sense, crafts and tells the story in other powerful language. And then if you visit Luke and Matthew, you see another struggle going on. Luke shifts the phrase while still saying, "You are my beloved Son." He has not the Spirit driving Jesus into the wilderness, but leading him into the wilderness. Matthew has John the Baptist saying, "I can't baptize you," but Jesus saying, "Let's just fulfill the Scriptures. Go ahead and do it." Well, what do we make of all of these texts? Like Bernard Christensen, we can be immobilized by their disagreement. We can find them to be something that tears apart our very faith because there is fundamental disagreement. Or one can say, as I think Bernard Christensen, and certainly I, inspired by people like Schussler Fiorenza and other biblical scholars, see that that early church was a widespread group of congregations spread around the world, struggling to make sense of the most powerful and overwhelming event that this world had been exposed to. The temptation to cross all the T's and dot all the I's and give us the absolute final word has always been in every religious tradition, the great seduction. To find closure that spells it out in a way that we can say, ah, don't change a thing, freeze the frame. Or one can live in the face of the mystery, as I think each gospel writer did, as I think you and I are called to do, which is like Bernard Christensen, to be confronted by the text and in each day of one's life sit down and rewrite one's theology, bringing together the word and the moment of history, be it a flood on the Red River, or a Hispanic week which we celebrate, or a Sverdrup lecture which invites us into new nuances of science. Will we be immobilized by the absence of the final word, or will we be invited, like Bernard Christensen was, to each day struggle with the text, struggle with the world, and write a statement of faith that is our best shot for this day, and knowing tomorrow it will have to be rewritten again. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, giver of every gift, we stand each day in awe of your creative will, your redeeming love, your gracious presence as we struggle to make you alive in our lives and in this community. Today we celebrate each person's gifts for community made possible by mutual respect and common endeavor for all that contributes to a common earth, our common home. This morning we especially pray for those in need, for those bent low in grief, for the lost and hopeless, for those suffering physical pain. And today we especially remember Denise Gooley's father, who will need to have his kidney removed, and Chris Chemnitz's mother, who has suffered a heart attack and awaits a decision on what is in store for her. Surround them with your grace and love and healing power. And we pray for all of this community and all of these people through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Before we do our final song, this is Latino Week, and Eloisa is here to give us an introduction to the week.
Good morning. Buenos días. I knew you knew that one. We are celebrating this week, Latino Week, and we have a full program starting today. A wonderful opportunity for us to share with you about the pride of our culture. And the theme is the many colors of Latin America. And as it says, we are celebrating the different cultures and subcultures within our Latino community, and starting today at 11:30, we are having in the Christensen Center all kinds of events, Latino lessons, dance by popular demand, and we have a mini plaza and a hosting country so you can have a taste of the different foods and dresses and music. We are going to have a live group, dancers and musicians and all that from different parts of Latin America. So we are very excited. We have put a lot of work on it, and we are really hoping that we can reach as many people from the Augsburg community. And then at 4:30 this afternoon, we are having a opening reception for our art exhibition. We have a Peruvian sculptor and a Mexican painter in the old main at 4:30 with a wonderful opening. There is a full schedule for you, and it will be handed to you when you leave. So I really encourage you and your friends and anyone that you can share about this. Please help us celebrate our Latino Week. Thank you.
This take a wine and the
This may be an inappropriate thing to do, but I'm going to try it anyway. Seeing you made reference to Bernard Christensen, you know, Nadia Christensen, who is Bernard's daughter, is in our midst every day, and she's here today in chapel. I know I see her regularly. Are you here still, Nadia? There she is. So it's neat to celebrate that Christensen tradition, and we owe a great deal to Bernard, who was one of the great professors I ever had at Luther Seminary. Receive the benediction. May the God who shakes heaven and earth, whom death could not contain, bless you with power to go forth and proclaim the gospel. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious, wise, and loving God, continue to bless this college as you have these many years. May it be a place of sound learning, new discovery, and the pursuit of wisdom. Bring to our student leaders this morning good character, a strong sense of purpose, and a spirit of understanding. Help them to remember their call to serve our community as lovers of truth and justice. We pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. I have the privilege this morning, this beautiful but chilling May morning, of thanking this year's student leaders for their dedication, insight, and guidance, which they have provided the Augsburg community. Leadership comes in many forms. There are over 40 different operational student organizations and many institutional organizations which students have been a part. As a result, there have been many avenues for leadership and many different styles of leadership to which the campus has been exposed. For those of you who have given your time in developing programs and activities so that others may explore new ideas and benefit in life at Augsburg, I sincerely hope that your blessings mirror your commitments. I have been personally blessed. The opportunities I have experienced here at Augsburg include sharing in life with all of you in a community of higher education, which has provided great spiritual growth. At Augsburg, we share insights, ideologies, emotions, concerns, and souls. For this, I am eternally grateful. But I have the prerogative this morning, mostly because I have the mic, to take the opportunity to briefly thank two people in particular who have been instrumental in this year's leadership. The first is Arlo Miller. And I do say brief because I'm unable to articulate all of the reasons he has been important in such a short speech. But for those of you who have worked with him, you know that Arlo demonstrates a very unique combination of ingenuity and efficiency. He has helped to redefine the qualities of a good Augsburg representative. On many occasions, I have found myself taken by surprise by some of Arlo's comments. Satirical but very insightful comments. He has helped to direct the process of leadership along a path which always starts and stops in his mind with the people he has agreed to represent. I want to thank Arlo for a terrific year and one which I will always remember. Now, the second person that I would like to thank today is my roommate, Liddy Howard, because she has been my support, and she has probably made my efforts that much more valuable to the people of the campus. She's there when I have problems. She's there when I cry. She's there when I'm happy, when I'm excited. And she always is continuing to move me forward in her support. For that, I will be ever grateful. But in keeping with today's theme of spring, we have come together because there is a new leadership budding, and it promises a good season. I wish next year's leadership the best, both to Duane in particular and Tony, because I know what you're going to expect or what you're going to be going through next year, and all I have to say is good luck. A position of true leadership can be exciting and rewarding, but also confusing and difficult. Fortunately, we are never alone. Therefore, I would like to finish with a prayer from Psalm 36, verses 5 through 9. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the great deep. O Lord, you preserve both man and beast. How priceless is your unfailing love. Both high and low among men find refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink for your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light, we see light. Amen. And now if you would turn to, I see is next on the agenda, using a Senate term, is hymn 558, Earth and All Stars.
Thank you. Well, today is definitely a day of transition for all of us in student government, and the first thing I would like to do is thank all the senators who I spent so much time with this year, and thank all of them for making it a wonderful year and going through all of the changes and growing pains of Sarah and my new administration last spring and early this fall. But my main order of business this morning is to deal with something new that Senate has created this year, and that's a service award. And already this morning, you've heard something about service. So I can say, unless you've been asleep at your stay at Augsburg, you've heard something about our motto, Education for Service. And as best as I can tell, this is a commitment that the college has made to creating people who make it a part of their life and hopefully a part of their day-to-day activity to spend time serving others. Well, this year, Senate decided to create an award that's not for students who exemplify service, but it's for on-campus departments who exemplify service. The criteria of this award is simply an award that goes to the department that we believe does the best job of serving students and makes it a point to see that our needs are being met in a courteous manner, rather than in a difficult or confrontational manner that causes students to, you know, become dissatisfied. Many students can name for you several departments that only seem to make them miserable. Only those students probably aren't here because they've left by now. There's one department, though, that does nothing short of an incredible job in improving our lives and helping us to find our place in the community around us. Many alum will tell you that they would not be in the places that they are if it had not been for people in this office. Any student who has visited them recently can tell you how helpful they are and how enjoyable they are to work with. They're the type of people that make your day just better just because you've talked to them. So on behalf of the 1996 Student Senate, I would like to invite Gary Hester to come forward to the stage and accept this award on behalf of the internship office. This is the inaugural year of the award. I wish everyone would join us in a round of applause for Gary Hester and all the members of the internship office.